Our speaker this week is Dr. Gerald McDermott, who joined the Beeson faculty in 2015 as the Anglican Professor of Divinity. He teaches in the areas of history and doctrine. He's the author of 18 books, including A Trinitarian Theology with Harold Detlin, Jonathan Edwards Confronts the Gods, The New Christian Zionism, Fresh Perspectives on Israel and the Land, Cancer, Medical and Theological Guide for Patients and Their Families, and his most recent book, Famous Stutterers. His academic focus has been threefold: Jonathan Edwards, the Christian understanding of other religions, and the meaning of Israel. As a renowned Edwards scholar, McDermott has produced 6 books on Edwards. His Theology of Jonathan Edwards, co-authored with Michael McClyman, won Christianity Today's 2013 award for top books in theology and ethics. Before coming to Beeson, he was a Jordan Trexler Professor of Religion at Roanoke College since 2008 and on faculty since 1989. An Anglican priest, he's an associate pastor at Christ the King Anglican Church, is married to Jean. Together they have 3 sons and 10 grandchildren. His hobbies include reading, running, grandkids, and the Boston Red Sox. And if I may be allowed a personal note or two, over the last couple of decades, I've written several book reviews for Bibliotheca Sacra. The first book review I wrote was his published dissertation on Holy and Happy Society. And soon after writing that book review, I had the opportunity to meet Jerry. I took the opportunity. We were at an Edwards conference together. And as a much younger junior scholar, PhD student, I was impressed with a man who treated me with courtesy and respect. He spent an extended period of time with me, and I have always been grateful for that. I hope, as you've met him this week, as you've spent time with him, you have found him to be a great scholar, an active churchman, and a virtuous Christian. Dr. Jerry McDermott.
Well, thank you, Glenn. You're blessed to have him on your faculty. I see I scared away some, but not as many as I'd feared. I do have to say that today's lecture is the most challenging of the 4. So put on your seatbelts. It gets much more earthy tomorrow and Friday. In yesterday's lecture, I talked about the typological view of reality that can be seen in the great tradition, from Gregory Nazianzus and Augustine, through Aquinas and Bonaventure, to Calvin and Edwards and Newman. Today, I want to discuss the theological pushback, starting with Martin Luther in the 16th century. Luther had a hard time separating properly Christian natural theology from the theologies of glory, as he put it, that he thought were responsible for the Catholic Church's late medieval teaching of semi-Pelagianism. Now, you know, I'm sure I don't want to insult you by defining for you semi-Pelagianism, but in case you walked in off the street and you're not a student here, that means God saves those who are sincere or who try their best. I mean, that's... In his Heidelberg Disputation, in 1518, Luther famously asserted that, quote, "that person does not deserve to be called a theologian who looks upon the invisible things of God as though they were clearly perceptible in those things which have actually happened." Now, it's a strange translation of the Latin. It's a bad translation of the Latin, which actually is a translation of the Greek much more literally. Those things which have been made. And I would argue in my footnote that this has probably influenced modern Lutheran theology on natural theology. It's a bad translation of Romans 1:20. So Luther's target was late medieval philosophical theologians who thought that they could use reason alone, apart from Scripture, to speculate about God's attributes. Now, Luther was insistent that apart from the revelation of the cross, nothing about God can be truly known by reason. In the absence of revelation from the Bible, reason, which he rightly said is never static or neutral, will immediately concoct a God whom the human self can manage. So Luther talked about a monk in his day, his proverbial monk, who imagines a God who forgives sins, and grants eternal life in exchange for good works. He clings to and trusts in this God. The problem is that this God does not exist. It's an idol. And this, according to Luther, is what naturally happens when reason looks at the created world and then analogizes from its beauty and goodness to a God who has only as much beauty and goodness as the monk's little mind can imagine. Not only is it a foolish exercise, for since when can the infinite God be anything like what our little minds can imagine, but the categories of beauty and goodness are devised by the monk. How is he to know that the true God's goodness and beauty are anything like what he conceives beauty and goodness to be? Remember, this is a monk philosopher who is deliberately setting the Bible aside and presuming to use reason alone to tell him about God. This, says Luther, is a theologian of glory who cannot imagine that beauty is found in the ugliness of the cross, or that goodness is precisely where a father permits his son to be murdered. Yet for all of Luther's insight into the folly of unaided reason's presumptions about God, Luther joined into one what God had separated. Luther joined into one what good Christian theology, following God, had separated. Namely, philosophical theology without the Bible and good biblical natural theology. Luther failed to properly distinguish them. Now, sometimes he properly distinguished them, but not enough to prevent prejudicing legions of followers over the centuries against all natural revelation and all Christian natural theology ever since. How did he do this? Well, in my humble opinion, he ignored the plain sense of the Bible when it most clearly speaks of the glory of God in creation. In his sermon on Psalm 19, which is one of the classic biblical texts on creation, the Holy Spirit proclaims through the psalmist, "The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims his handiwork." That's verse 1. Now, Luther interprets this verse as follows. Now, here's pure Luther speaking. "That is to say, the glory of God is preached everywhere in all the lands under all of heaven." The emphasis is on the word telling, to remind us that we should esteem the oral and external word. The glory of God, now this is still Luther, the glory of God is the gospel, for through the gospel God is known. The handiwork of God is all the works wrought by the gospel, like justification, salvation, and redemption from sin, and from death, and from the kingdom of the devil. Stop. When verse 2 in Psalm 19 proclaims that day to day pours forth speech and night to night declares knowledge, Luther tells us that this is to say, quote, that the gospel will always be preached and the Christian church will stand and remain eternally, close quote. Notice what's happened. Or notice what Luther has done. Here, where the Bible contains a clear proclamation of its theology of creation, that God's glory can be seen in the heavens and the earth, Luther has replaced it with a theology of redemption. He asserts that the heavens are not the stars and the firmament is not the sky. No, they are the oral preaching of the word at church. And they are the good works that are produced by that church preaching. So the glory of God in this verse is not talking about the beauty of the stars at night, but instead what happens inside a church. Just as the moon is obscured by the rising sun at dawn, the glory of nature has been swept from view to reveal instead a preacher in a pulpit. Now, I'm not against preachers and pulpits, but I don't think that's what Psalm 19:1 is talking about, or verse 2. If Psalm 19 is one of the best known Old Testament passages about types in the creation, Romans 1, 18 through 23 is the best known New Testament passage. Now, we just heard how Luther used it in his Heidelberg Disputation. When he comments on Romans 1, he declares that the invisible things of God, which Paul says in Romans 1, are clearly seen. Luther says they're not clearly seen. Now, Luther goes on to explain why. Now, he's a smart man. I'm not saying he's dumb. He has one of the most brilliant minds in the history of the church. However, he writes in his commentary on Romans 1, while God does indeed reveal his existence and power and even goodness through nature, and while unaided reason does indeed discern those realities, nevertheless, those realities are immediately obscured by sin. Sin inevitably corrupts that true knowledge. This is why, Luther explains, Paul goes on to say in verse 21, that, quote, they became futile in their thinking and their senseless minds were darkened, close quote. Now, later Lutheran theologians used this treatment of natural revelation by God to characterize all natural theology. Roland Ziegler wrote recently, and he's a Missouri Synod theologian at Concordia Seminary in St. Louis. He says, quote, in the hands of man, the natural revelation of the true God is turned into an idolatrous concept of God and gods. The problem of man is therefore not simply an intellectual one, it's sin. And the remedy for this is not a return to a pure or better natural theology, but the proclamation of Christ. Now, Ziegler's interpretation is similar to that of the 19th century Lutheran theologian August Graebner, who wrote, quote, God's handwriting still covers every inch of the universe, but man's defective mental vision prevents him from ever making out, even with his telescopes and microscopes, what the heavens as well as the mustard seeds declare, close quote. So for these Lutheran theologians, God's types in nature are useless because they're inevitably distorted by sinful human minds. They serve only to condemn, for they show that human beings have no excuse for their idolatry since they were originally given revelation of the true God, but they replaced it immediately and inevitably with images of false gods. This is what happens whenever hapless Christian theologians think anything useful is made of God's revelation in nature. As a contemporary Lutheran theologian writes, whom I know, if any constructive space is given natural revelation, it becomes natural theology, and the consequences are dire for the scriptural doctrine of the Trinity and our confession of the pure gospel, close quote. Now, Luther and these Lutherans are right, I think, about the consequences of a natural theology that presumes that unregenerate reason can be disinterested and neutral, and that this reason, this unregenerate reason, can ascend, and that was Luther's word, ascend, go up to the divine realm without the guidance of revelation. Luther wrote that when unbelievers see God in nature, they see only his wrath. For Paul writes in Romans 1:18 that the wrath of God, not the righteousness of God, is being revealed from heaven. And so the philosopher using reason alone can have what Luther called a left-handed and partial knowledge of God, but he cannot know God's will for him, particularly whether God will forgive him. Sin confuses all knowledge gained from natural revelation, so all so-called natural knowledge must die before it's resurrected in faith. And at that point, it must submit to the revelation of God in Scripture. But what if Reason is used in the way that most of the great tradition used it. What if it's faith seeking understanding, as Augustine first put it? What if it's a prayerful exploration, carefully mining the riches of revelation in the Bible as it was used by Cyril of Jerusalem, Basil of Caesarea, Gregory Nazianzus, and Augustine? They spoke of faith's reason and reason's faith, faith informing reason and giving fullness to reason. Gregory of Nazianzus, for example, used biblically informed reason to write a hymn to nature, which inspires humility before God. He used it to argue the irrationality of reason trying to know God without the use of biblical revelation from God. So despite Luther's blasts against reason as that whore, one of his more famous phrases, even he seemed to allow for this kind of humble and pious typological theology. In the Heidelberg Disputation, he wrote that it's no use trying to see God's glory and majesty, quote, unless the theologian also recognizes God in the humility and shame of the cross. Notice the unless, which implies that God's glory and majesty can be seen by those who embrace the shame of the cross. Believers who know that God's beauty is in that very ugliness. Those believers can then go on to see God's glory in the creation. In fact, Luther says just that in the Disputation, quote, he deserves to be called a theologian, however, who comprehends the visible and manifest things of God seen through suffering in the cross, close quote. So what shall we finally say about Luther and his doctrine of natural revelation? Luther was brilliant in his denunciation of presumptuous natural theology that tries to soar up to heaven without the wings of revelation. He rightly protested that that flight was headed toward a dark realm of alien beings. But Luther was so obsessed with human presumption about glory that he gave little attention to believers who humbly consider the beauties of God scattered throughout the creation. They know the greatest glory was in the cross, and therefore they can also know the glory of God that's in the earth and the heavens. They can see God's handiwork in the firmament. Now, later Lutheran and other sorts of theologians warned that all the analogies we use to talk about God are rooted in human terms and human concepts, things in nature as perceived by our limited minds. They suggest that it borders on illegitimate to imagine that God could be anything like the things we see in nature and history, and that we should hesitate, therefore, to even imagine that we can jump from nature and history to God. But the authors of Scripture, it seems to me, show no such hesitation. The authors of Scripture regularly compare God to a rock and a storm and the sun. His wrath, the authors of Scripture write, is like the ocean. His righteousness is like the mountains. God himself is like a human father in some ways, a shepherd, a vineyard owner. Jesus said he is bread, a vine, a king. Perhaps there is a place, after all, for believing use of natural revelation. Karl Barth. But wait a minute. Aren't we getting too big for our britches here? Haven't we learned in the 20th century that we were duped on all this? That what we think is natural revelation is not really natural revelation. That this was the argument made by the most influential theologian of the 20th century, Karl Barth. Barth argued that there's no famous point of contact between things of earth and things of heaven, and that when we think there is, we inevitably confuse the two, assigning something of earth to the heavenly sphere, turning it into a god by trusting in it and loving it. If you think this sounds like Luther, you're on the right track. Barth was steeped in the reformers, Luther as much as Calvin. Luther helped Barth make sense of the insanity of early 20th century Europe, when millions of young men were mowed down in line after line as they climbed out of filthy trenches in France to face a faceless enemy whom their leaders had told them was a threat to civilization. Barth was horrified to learn that his liberal theology professors had endorsed this senseless First World War, confusing German ideals with God's purposes. This made him rethink theology and God himself, and drove him back to the Reformed scholastics, whom he found in Heinrich Heppe's Reformed Dogmatics. These theologians took seriously what Barth called the strange new world of the Bible. Unlike his liberal theology professors who questioned the historicity of both testaments, these Reformed theologians in the 16th and 17th centuries believed God had inspired every word of the scriptures, and that the relation between each word and its historical referent was less important than the fact that the living God was speaking through those words. Then in the 1930s, when the most Christianized country in Europe turned against its fathers, the Jews, and when the most educated country in history per capita, Germany in the 30s had the highest percentage of PhDs, master's, and bachelor's degrees of any country before or since. It makes us think of Roussas Rushdoony's famous book about 50, 60 years ago, The Messianic Character of American Education, Education as Messiah. When the most educated country in history allowed itself to believe lies, Barth turned again to Reformed theology and Luther to make sense of the madness. Barth was struck by Luther's rejection of Aquinas, and the medieval doctors turned to this world of being, now this is Aquinas, to find analogies to the author of being. Even though Thomas said that these analogies tell us more about what God is not than what he is, Luther considered all such analogies to this world to be dead ends. In the end, Luther taught, they turned us to our own ideas of the world and suggested that we can contribute something to the search for God and then to our being accepted by God. In Thomistic theology, this was known as the analogy of being, which asserted that in the creation, we can see signposts of the creator, earmarks left by the designer. We can use our unaided reason to study these signposts and earmarks and conclude from them that they point to an intelligent designer, indeed, a creator. For Barth, this approach to the creation was exactly the one used by the new generation of German theologians who were supporting this new religion of blood and soil, suggested by an Austrian sign painter with a preternatural gift of oratory. This failed artist was giving hope to a generation of Germans who felt inferior after the Versailles Treaty had blamed the First World War on them and left them penniless because of the draconian reparations demanded by the treaty. Hitler told them they were not only inferior, but superior. That they were not only not inferior, but superior. And his rearmament of Germany was giving them jobs. Now they could put food on the table, and with it, self-respect. He told them he read the Bible every day and was protecting them from godless communism, and that God raises up leaders who enable a people to find their God-given strength and destiny. For Barth, this was the handwriting on the wall. This showed why the analogy of being was damnable from the infernal pit, in fact, the invention of Antichrist. Now, those are his words. It claimed to find God in the creation and in a particular people. It makes the human being its own creator and redeemer. Now, we can understand in hindsight why Barth connected the dots from Thomas's analogy of being to the Nazi Blut und Boden. But that same hindsight reveals that Barth overreached, overreacted. As Hans Urs von Balthasar argued in his seminal study of Barth's theology, Barth had attacked a straw man. The analogy of being, which Barth condemned, was not the one taught by Thomas Aquinas. Barth had claimed that for Thomas, nature was able, in its purity, apart from grace, to see the meaning of reality. And not only to see, but then to contribute to its own salvation. But Thomas never taught such a pure nature that could, of its own being, apart from regeneration, see the meaning of nature and the identity of the true God. Thomas always insisted that nature requires grace to find itself, and that only the historical event of Christ's life, death, and resurrection saves a fallen nature. As Balthasar put it, Thomas wrote that the Word did not come to all of nature, but to his own, John 1:11. And that part of his own who received him had been prepared by grace. They were born not of blood or the will of the flesh or the will of man, but of God, John 1:12. Therefore, the analogy of being, which depends on grace to see and grace to be redeemed, teaches that being is indeed epiphanic. You know, this is the season of Epiphany, the season of showing. All of nature is created with the capacity to show the grace that birthed it and lies beyond it. For example, all genuine love in this world surrenders to the other and points to the surrender of each divine person to the Trinity's plan for creation and redemption. All the fallen creation goes through death in order to make way for new life, just as death to sin is necessary for the resurrection of new life in redemption and sanctification. In these two ways, and millions of others, the creation shows that God is the fulfillment of the world's being. But only eyes that have been opened by the Holy Spirit can see this. This is where the true analogy of being is different from its counterfeit in deism and liberal theology. But Barth was never able to see this distinction or to separate the analogia entis, that's Latin for the analogy of being, from general revelation in any clear way. For him, the two were of a piece, of the same cloth. Claims for both, he said, assumed, quote, an inborn or acquired property of man, close quote, rather than the result of an act of God. Or that man, quote, has created his own faith, which we acquire on our own, or involve in abstract metaphysics of God, the world, or religion, which is supposed to obtain at all times and all places, close quote. Now this part. He insisted in Church Dogmatics 2:1 that Romans 1:18 and following is not speaking of man in the cosmos in himself and in general, close quote. Paul refers here, Barth claimed, not to some knowledge of God possible apart from knowledge of Jesus Christ, but only the truth of revelation proclaimed by the apostle of Jesus Christ. He said it's impossible to draw from this text in Romans 1 a statement concerning any natural union with God or knowledge of God on the part of man in himself and as such. Close quote. In Barth's discussion of Romans 1 and Paul's Mars Hill sermon in Acts 17, he denied any natural analogy between the creation and its creator, and any revelation available to all human beings apart from the revelation of Jesus Christ, hence general revelation. The rejection of the analogy and of general revelation went together. Well, what about Barth's appeals later in his career to what he called little lights and parables of the kingdom? Don't these discussions represent that Barth changed his mind later on general revelation? No. Barth argued that the occurrence of such parables was not to be ascribed to what he put as the sorry hypothesis of natural theology. As George Hunsinger explains, Barth could not accept any true apprehension of God without personal conversion. So no one, apart from accepting Jesus, knows anything true about the true God. That's what it comes down to. Nothing. The notion that there could be objective revelation that was there, even if a person could not apprehend it, this too was impossible for Barth to accept. Now, James Barr, in his theology, in his Gifford lectures, he agreed there was no change in the later Barth. He said, quote, there was no talk of a revision, still less of an abandonment of the violent earlier attacks on natural theology. Since this is so, we are justified, he says, Barr said, in taking the position of Barth's complete denial of natural theology, which was Barth's position in his Gifford lectures, in his controversy with his famous controversy with Emil Brunner, and in the earlier volumes of the Church of Dogmatics. This was the classic Barthian position. No natural revelation exists. Now, the great Lutheran theologian Wolfhard Pannenberg, the greatest Lutheran theologian of the 20th century, studied under Barth and saw this problem in Barth's theology. Now, Pannenberg observed that Barth could not distinguish between natural knowledge of God and a natural theology constructed by autonomous man. As a result, according to Pannenberg, Barth created a false dichotomy. Either Enlightenment-style natural theology that thinks natural reason can have saving knowledge of God, or no general revelation at all. Either knowledge of God apart from knowledge of Christ was something possessed by a human being for her disposal, or there was no knowledge of God at all apart from revelation of the gospel. The great Dutch Reformed theologian G.C. Berkauer joined Pannenberg in criticizing Barth for failing to distinguish between natural theology of the Enlightenment sort from explicitly Christian natural theology based on general revelation. More recently, Alistair McGrath, who gave these lectures, I understand, a few years ago, has added a similar critique, along with a new call for revival of a properly Christian natural theology. Now we must get into the weeds and see how Barth misinterpreted Scripture. Barth went to the classic texts, not only Acts 17, as we just saw, but also Psalm 19 and Romans 1. On Psalm 19, he pointed to verse 3. Their voice is not heard. And he argued on the basis of that, that the voices of creation are dumb and mute. After all, he wrote, the Old Testament shows that no one outside of Israel knew the true God. I say, oh, really? How about Melchizedek? How about Job? On Romans 1, Barth argued, following Luther, that all the so-called revelation of God to man through nature results only in condemnation. Therefore, Barth reasoned, since the testimonies of God in nature are invariably misunderstood, they are not revelation at all. They falsify rather than illumine. The only true knowledge of God is in the face of Jesus Christ. And by implication, all the supposed types which observers say they find in nature and history and which point to the true God are counterfeit, pointing instead to things other than the true God that are merely imagined in likeness to the observers. In a word, they are idols. The search for types is a wild goose chase with a pagan god at its end. But Barth, I would argue, was practicing eisegesis, not exegesis. He was reading into rather than out of the text. When the psalmist said of the voices of the creation that they are not heard, he probably meant that their voice is not understood rather than that it's not sounded. For he went on to say that these voices go out through all the earth and reach to the end of the world. The point of the psalmist seems to be that their voices are sounded to all the world, not just Israel. Something is being proclaimed to the world outside of Israel, even if it's not always understood or received. And in Romans, Paul says the same thing. In seven different ways, he claims that God is making himself known to every human heart, on which he has written his law, his Torah. Now that's the first way. Back in Romans 1, he claims, for what can be known about God, now that's number 2, is plain to them, 3, because God has shown it to them, 4. Ever since the creation of the world, his eternal power and divine nature, invisible though they are, have been understood, 5, and seen, 6, through the things he has made. So they are without excuse, for though they knew God, 7, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him. Barth is right that Paul suggests that this general revelation simply leads to condemnation. After all, Paul says, these same human beings exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshiped and served the creature rather than the creator. But we must remember 3 things. I've added one. First, Paul was speaking of the universal tendency of every human being to turn away from God to self and world. Now, this was true of every believer before the grace of God turned him back to God. It speaks of the fall, not redemption from fall, of the tendency to misread the signs in creation, not the legitimacy of the signs themselves. Just because our sinful tendency before redemption is to misread does not mean that once redeemed, we cannot learn to read properly. Second, Paul clearly repeats 7 times that the message comes through loud and clear about who the Creator is and some things about this Creator. Third, Scripture suggests that some fallen creatures can see something in the signs to encourage a search for the true sign maker. As this same Paul told the Athenians on Mars Hill in Acts 17, God allotted the times of human beings' existence and the boundaries of their places where they should live, so they would search for God and perhaps grope for him and perhaps find him. So Psalm 19 and Romans 1 teach that there is natural revelation from God. God speaks through nature of his existence and power and deity. Most use this revelation most of the time for idolatrous purposes, but it's revelation nonetheless. Scripture suggests that some unbelievers might use this natural revelation as an incentive to search for the true God, the God of Israel. This search, if it's successful, always leads to the Trinitarian God of Scripture, and is always both inspired by the Holy Spirit and led by the Holy Spirit. Human nature by itself is powerless to see the meaning of the signs or to follow them to the true God, but God uses his signs to open eyes to his glory in his creation. So what can we say about Barth? He rightly warned of our temptation to confuse culture with Christ, and disastrously so. But his rejection of Scripture's testimony to natural revelation was more the result of an a priori view of revelation than an unprejudiced reading of the biblical text itself. So Barth departed from the majority view of the great tradition that while there's no saving knowledge of God in nature, there is nevertheless true knowledge in nature that is available to the unregenerate, and that the regenerate have available to them a near infinite panoply number of revelations in man and the world testifying to the truths of redemption by the triune God. So Barth departed from Basil and Gregory and Augustine and Thomas and Calvin and Edwards on this, and even from many of the Reformed and Lutheran scholastics. In my next lecture tomorrow, I'll talk about divine types in nature. First, we'll look at Scripture's testimony to this, and there's far more than most Christians have ever imagined, and then to some intriguing and surprising types outside of Scripture. So, questions. We've got time for questions. Thoughts about Luther and Barth, natural revelation, natural theology.
Is this on? So, in conclusion, would you say that natural revelation is useful for the Christian in two ways, perhaps in joining in the worship and praise of God and using it as maybe the signposts and types to convince, in maybe more evocative language, convince our fellow human beings, look, this points to not just any God, but to the one God?
Yes.
All right.
Well put. Well put.
I followed.
Tov. Meod, Tov.
So Barth and Luther obviously disagreed some in their theology, or they differed, I guess. So what do you think drew, like from your studies, what do you think drew Barth to Luther as opposed to maybe some of the other Reformed theologians?
Well, Barth was drawn also to Calvin, and maybe even a little bit more Calvin than Luther. But, I think he grossly, and it's not just me, I mean many other scholars think that Barth grossly misrepresented Calvin on natural revelation. Calvin clearly believed in this. He said, as I said yesterday, this world is a theater of God's glory. And he really presented a caricature of Calvin on general revelation. But your question was, what drove Barth to Luther? I think because Luther really talked about idolatry more. Calvin did an awful lot too. But Luther, even more so. And of course, Luther was directed, was directing his attacks almost entirely against Rome. But the connection was Nazism. You know, this is all about Nazism and Barth's challenge to a religion of blood and soil. And I mean, I commend Barth, I think we all do, for standing up as much as he did. He didn't go as far as many critics wish he would have gone against the Nazis, but he did stand up, and we're grateful for that. But unfortunately, like in the history, in many examples of the history of theology, when theologians stand up against a great important heresy, sometimes they overreach and sometimes throw the baby out with the bathwater, as in this case, I think. Sir.
Hello.
Just making sure it works. Had a question about, I guess, conversion in terms of natural theology. Do you believe that natural theology alone can like lead somebody to know who Jesus is, or
well,
I mean, obviously, or can it just like start them on the path, or how do you frame that? How that works?
I must not have been speaking very clearly. If you're asking that,
sorry about that.
I have to correct these lectures. No, natural revelation is not saving. Yeah. It is not saving, and if I haven't made that clear, then I've really not done my job well. But natural revelation does reveal. It's revelation. It shows us that, you know, Paul says, from the creation in Romans 1, we can see, A, that there is a God, and unaided reason. Now, see, here's the kicker. That's the kicker. Can the unregenerate, using his or her reason, look around at the beauties of creation? Well, out there is... you know, top of a mountain on a starry night, at the ocean during a storm, looking under a microscope at the incredible beauty and complexity of the tiny things in a cell. Can the atheist see, whoa, there is beauty, there's complexity, and yet it seems to be some sort of intelligent design here? Can that happen? And I think the Apostle Paul says in Romans 1, yes, it happens all the time. Can reason discern something about the true God, that God is? As Francis Schaeffer used to say, the God who is, and he's there? Yes. I think that's what a plain sense reading of the Bible tells us. And until Barth came along, that's what almost all the tradition agreed on. It was only in the 20th century, starting with Barth, that Protestants particularly had thrown that out the window. Now, Catholics are much better on that. But Protestants, and as I said yesterday, we have so focused rightly on a theology of redemption that we've almost lost a theology of creation. And, you know, a lot of us Protestants are now starting to reclaim a better, more biblical theology of creation. So my project is part of that.